We've all seen polar bears in zoos behind nice, strong concrete and reinforced glass and moats. But it's a different thing entirely to see one in the wild, as I found out on a recent canoeing trip in northern Manitoba along a river named after another famous Arctic animal, the caribou.
Unique river in Manitoba that runs right through the shield, the tag of shield right into the Arctic tundra, and it drops 232 meters from Commonwealth Lake down to Hudson Bay over a series of rapids and small lakes, and that's a meter per kilometer, and that's a fair drop.
It's really barren but there's a beauty here that's unlike anything else I've seen. Ever. You just have a sense that life is so fragile. Further south it's lush and it's easier for things to grow and exist, but here it's just so tenuous.
End of the lake, as you can see out there.
Right.
This lake is roughly 4 by 4 kilometers. An old meteor strike lake. But we go down here about 3 kilometers and then leave the lake at this point, roughly about 3 kilometers from here.
Uh-huh.
Head in the south, the easterly direction.
Sounds good.
One of the customs and traditions is the tobacco ceremony. Putting a little bit of tobacco, making a little personal wish. Personally, I just want to ask for safety for everybody and a good time, and that we all help each other out, and we'll just take it as it comes, and always respect the environment here and each other. And I think it's going to be a good trip.
How's the suffering level?
Very hard.
Very hard, yeah. I guess you've never been pitted against something like this before.
So we're on that little...
Where are we now?
On this narrow section here, I think.
What's ahead?
Just opens up into a little... Well, it looks like a little pondy section on my map, but I think it's bigger than that.
All right.
And then it gets narrow again, and then there's a rapids coming up.
It's almost 200 rapids. Most are not indicated on the or in any kind of accuracy on the topographic maps. It's not unusual.
Okay.
It's kind of a what we call threading the needle, you know, bump and grind type of running. It's hard on the equipment, hard on the bodies, but still lots of fun.
So we're down to the white bagels?
We are, yeah. White bagels, the last of the brown bagels, and then we're on to the bread.
All right. Pete?
Yeah.
Would you say that... What would you say here, anyway? At this stage of the expedition, what's your feeling about it?
It's an experience.
Experience.
It's an experience.
And we've done this so far. It's about 6 o'clock.
It's just barely over the edge.
What I did not expect to find more than 1,000 kilometers north of Winnipeg were sand dunes. Glorious sand dunes heaped along the edge of the river and along every little lake, so that sometimes you think you must be in a desert rather than being right on the edge of the Arctic tundra. The truth is, I keep my bear guard very, very handy. We're in country here where we're close enough to the tundra so that there are, in fact, creatures known as tundra grizzlies. And of course, this is polar bear country. Anybody who doesn't at least keep some bear guard around is asking for trouble. So it behooves us to walk as softly as we can and to listen. What have we got this morning?
This is, I think it's got corned beef, canned corned beef, mashed potatoes, and stovetop.
Absolutely
fantastic.
All right.
You approve of it?
I do. It's fantastic.
All right, yeah. Walt?
I'll have some too.
Yep.
Plan, Bob, you're going to sail if the wind cooperates. Uh-huh. And we'll make about 12, 14 kilometers.
Across Caribou Lake.
Across Caribou Lake.
Right. Oh.
Sit back and relax.
And here we are taking some of man's most ancient technology and some of the newest.
Wind power.
Boom, boom, boom. Coupled with...
What's this stuff made of? Yeah, that's just a nylon tarp.
Nylon says modern to me.
Back on the left.
Hard left.
Forward.
On the left.
The captains are there.
We like it.
Son of a bitch, we made it.
Let's hear it for the captain.
Go for it.
Okay. Hey, all right.
Hey.
So Peter, you almost got washed away in the rapids. Is that the gist of it?
I don't know how to describe that sensation, actually. The flowing current, the slippery rocks. That is actually, you know, not being funny for a moment, is that the thing that's most terrifying is that you get no grip on the rocks. And the thing I'm really worried about is slipping, not falling in. I mean, I can manage that. But breaking an arm or breaking an ankle or something like that, which is quite a possibility. This is Walter, and this is Yuri. And these guys are, they never get their feet wet. Let me show you. Look, their feet are dry. Okay,
did you notice that? Yeah. I saw Yuri slip Look and slide.
You did?
In at the top of a rapid.
Is this true, Yuri?
This is true.
God.
Yeah, but look at my feet.
They're
wet. Now, I was soaked up to here. Up to
really
high. His feet are dry.
Now, look at my feet, for instance.
Look at your feet.
Yeah, that's pretty sad, too. No, I was sabotaged by black flies that came down and bit pitilessly into my legs, making hideous wounds that caused poison to flow up to my knees and ruin my knees.
That's kind of cute, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are we having fun?
Yeah, we are.
So the big question is, why?
What Edmund Hillary said, they said, well, why did you climb Mount Everest? And he said, succinctly, because it's there. Why are we doing this down the Caribou River? Because the river is here, and we are trying to find at least some measure of our human endurance and our capability to survive in this sort of a situation.
They are like white fish.
Whoa, smokes, huh?
Is that a big one?
Yep.
Pretty good, yeah.
All right. So we eat tonight. Grayling, these are called?
Yep.
They're peculiar to northern Manitoba, I guess.
I think Arctic.
Arctic fish.
Arctic fish. Yeah, Arctic fish. I think they get about as big as 3 pounds.
So what have we got here, Steve?
Grayling fettuccine.
All right. Now, grayling fettuccine. Hap, where can you buy this?
Hey, at any corner drugstore. It comes in a boiler bag.
Okay.
And that's all, we just boil a bag, throw it in a pot of hot water.
It's the only place in the world right now that's serving grayling fettuccine.
That's right. Now, Hap is a man who likes to pull your leg. It's all strong, silent men of the North do. What is it really, Steph?
Good timing, Bob.
Good enough.
The shores of the Caribou River.
Quite a pile of stuff, Peter.
Yeah, it's... It's a usual thing, Bob, trying to sort it out, to figure out what you're going to need next and why. For example, do I really need these? No. So where do they go? They go in a bag of the non-usables.
Aha. Non-usable. Well, then unusable. Okay.
Okay.
All right. That too.
Pajamas. I don't think they have much use up here.
Out here, I don't think so. This is called an esker. This one happens to run parallel the Caribou River. It's sort of a reverse river itself, a hump of rocks and gravel that runs for thousands of miles. And it's along these trails, it's kind of a highway through the tundra, that the natives have been traveling all these years in pursuit of the caribou.
We're on the dividing line?
Yeah, this is the transition between the Shield Taiga ecozone and the Hudson Plain ecozone. We have the rock barren lands from here, which is quite unique for Manitoba. It's quite similar to the barren lands in Northwest Territories. And from here we drop 60 meters to basically to the ocean.
Down there?
Yeah. Follows the caribou down that drop into more typical sort of Hudson Bay lowland type vegetation. The river will probably close in, thick sedge along the shoreline.
Why the gun, huh?
We're only about 25 kilometers from Hudson Bay, and polar bears do range within this area.
So we're in polar bear country.
We are in polar bear country here.
Smile at that, though.
Sparse as the land seems, when you get close to it and take a close, hard look, you can see how it works a bit, the ecosystem. Now, there's these little plants here with berries on them. The berries must get eaten by birds and carried here and there. Something sustains the plants. Something also sustains the lichen that's growing here and bits of moss. Otherwise, it's all rock and gravel. Yet when we look at it more closely, we find things like the leftover bits, broken up chunks of caribou dung, which dries out and becomes almost a kind of a straw, which also blows away on the wind. And that creates fertilizer that sustains all the other little plants that ultimately sustain the animal life. How many we got there, Pete?
Five, two. One really old-looking guy.
Oh, yeah.
Huge antlers and a mottled sort of grayish coat. I don't know. I don't know much about caribou, but I assume he was an old one. He was a leader.
Are you having trouble getting out of the water, Steve?
Yeah.
I think we're in the we're camped on their path. I think they come across that esker.
Well, the last one's out of the water, but they look like they have a hard time getting out of the water at first.
Yeah, they don't belong there.
Yeah.
It's probably really easy.
They're not used to their footing over there, I guess. Uh-huh. Well, I'm not either.
And then, of course, there are some rapids where things just don't work out perfectly. You all right, Pete?
Yeah. It's just unbelievable how it happened. We thought we were going through and bang.
Yeah, quick.
That's a cruel river.
This is a river that's never been dammed. It doesn't look like it will be.
No development. It even escaped the mining and prospecting that the Seal River did, which is about 30, 40 kilometers south of here. There's the only indication of man's presence here is some Dene trappers who maybe come through here in the 30s, 40s, 50s and left some tin cans behind. That's it. There's no other sign except the odd dolmen stone and rock cairn.
You didn't tell me about these either. Don't say that. You mentioned this.
Okay, this part is all fogged. So I can just shoot with this, Steve?
You should be able to.
Because we're fools.
Idiots.
Fools.
Good looking animal.
Hey?
Really good looking animal.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, no, hey, get the other clip out.
You think it was a young one?
I don't know if it was a young one or not. I don't think it was. A young one would probably be more curious.
Right.
And less likely to run off. It would probably, I would think if it was a young one, it would probably walk the shore just to get a better view of what was going on.
Seemed awfully big. I mean,
oh, yeah.
Big to me.
It seemed very big.
Yeah, that wasn't small, was it?
No.
Yeah.
Size.
First polar bear, Walter?
Yes. First real fat polar bear.
Well, that's first time I've seen a polar bear in the wild.
Look at his paws. Wow.
Does seem to be entering the water. Which means he's coming towards us.
The polar bear is also known as Nanook, the spirit bear. Mainly he eats beached beluga whales and seals when he can get them. The females weigh up to 500 pounds and the males up to 1,000 pounds. They can smell odors as far away as 20 miles, and they can smell a seal beneath the ice at 3 feet.
We were prepared.
They can swim twice as fast as two people paddling in a canoe.
Have a look how he runs over the rock.
Be graceful.
Yeah.
Later, I realized I just had an experience that my children would probably never have. In the time since I've been back from the Caribou River, there have been reports confirming that global warming is happening and that the Arctic environment is one of the first places being affected. So it may be in my children's time, the only place that the mighty spirit bear will survive will be in zoos. I'm Bob Hunter for Cable Pulse 24.